not of weight. Anyway, I live in Champagne, and I moved from Jerusalem, and I think that I always start with this joke about Champagne. And yeah, they're gonna kick me, I think, from Champagne at one point. The university is just wonderful, it's great, and it's, the city is too flat if you have been in Champagne. And I remember when we landed, it was traumatic. In the summer of 2014, we landed in Chicago, and I just wanted to make my kids. I have three kids. My daughter is 16, and then the boys are 11 and 5. They are now treating Champagne. They feel American. We'll see what's going to happen next week. But meanwhile, they feel American. So I remember that we landed in O'Hare, and they rented a car, and they started driving from Chicago to Champagne, following the GPS, and just wanted to make it like feel like home for the kids. And we just went out of Chicago, and they pointed at the first cornfield to the kids. Look, it's a cornfield, like it's a magic. And because I didn't know that's going to be the same cornfield all the 2.5 hours all the way to Champagne. And I remember my daughter, she was 14 back then, and I said, well, I thought we're coming like America, Daddy. Beyonce and Drake and stuff, Champagne, we had no idea what to do with that. Like even the basic things, swear to God, it's just like to order food, you know, I entered the Subway. That's the most American, that's if we want to be Americans, we have to eat at Subway, the first thing we should eat at Subway. And it was so, I was so nervous because you have to like, then I realized fast food is not served fast, but you have to also order very fast. I remember it's 6-inch or 12, I have no idea what a 6-inch or what the big wheat one, white Italian, and she was the lady there, and Subway was so mad at me because I don't know how to, and now I order just in seconds the Italian sandwich with the whatever, so but it was tough. And cicadas, I always call the cicadas. You know, cicadas, that was a lot of noise. And also it rains in the summer, and I'm not used to it that it rains in the summer. And I remember that my little son, he was 3 back then, he got a little fever, and I didn't know even what to do. I went to the pharmacy, and they got him a thermometer, I was cool. And it was 100.7 or something like that. I don't know what is 100.7. It didn't mean anything to me if he got fever or not. And then we go to the walk-in clinic, and it costs just $150 because of all the things. And it's so terrifying, opening a bank account and credit history. I just discovered that I have a problem with history. I always thought it's the history of being Palestinians and the Nakba, but no, I have a real problem with credit history here. And it was, everything was so, and the house that we rented from Sabbatical Homes was nothing like the photos that we saw on the internet. And even the people were not yet in the University of Illinois, just to be in touch, everyone was in just vacation. And I remember that it was so sad, being there in Champagne at the beginning, and then I always tell the story that when I started to love Champagne, at one point I had to register my kids to the public schools in Champagne, and they have this office, so I asked the people, and they told me, oh, you have to, I googled it, unit for school, it's called, so I took my 3 kids, and we went to the unit for school, and I was dealing with the forms there, filling the forms, and everything is just, so nervous. And then at one point there was form with the race. I said, again, like I'm escaping the old idea of the race. I just wanted to vacation from the race issues, and now I have to deal with race again. So I was looking for my race in the list of the race, and I was looking for the Arabs. And there were no Arabs. I said, what did they do to the Arabs? And also I taught my kids 2 things when we arrived to the States. Like I always feel like I have to be a parent and teach my kids something as a father should do, but I never do actually. So I thought that you have to remember 2 things here in the States. People here do stand in line, because in Israel no one stands in line. And the other thing, if anyone asks you where I'm from, because we're not familiar yet with you know, we know that the states are huge supporters of Israel. If you ask where you're from, you say Jerusalem. And according to the response, you choose if it's East or West Jerusalem. That's the dignity that they have when it comes to national identity. So I was looking for the race, and there are no Arabs. And I'm carrying Israeli passport because I'm Palestinian, but still a citizen of Israel. And we know all about Judaism. Trust me, like I will pass as Jewish in any test. And my kids as well, the Hebrew was perfect, of course. And so I was looking for Jewish in the list of the race, and there were no Jews also in the list of the race. I remember like it was white, black, Asian, something like that. No Arabs, Hispanic, no Arabs and no Jews. That was confusing. And I could easily sign my kids, register my kids as Asians, because I can easily prove that Jerusalem is part of Asia. But I didn't want to lose my visa, J1 visa, in the very first week that we arrived. Because I know it sounds bad and racist, maybe, but I'm Palestinian, so I can be racist. But they almost registered my kids as Asians because I thought maybe they will be good in science one day or something like that. And then I raised my hand because I don't know what is my race. And this lady came to me, "Yes, sir, how can I help you?" I said, I don't know what is my race. And she said, "Oh, where are you from, sir?" I said, "From Jerusalem." Like, giving this look to my kids, like, learn how to survive in the jungle, Jerusalem. "Oh, you're from the Middle East?" Yes. I said, "Oh, you're white, sir." "Thank you." It was the happiest moment. I remember that I registered my kids like white, and they looked at them differently with a new kind of respect. Not that they know what to do with being white. So I had no idea what to do with it. But I remember that it changed my whole life. Like, okay, we love champagne, and now we are white people in champagne. I don't know what does that mean. So the next morning I bought the Jeep Liberty for a reason. I don't know. I thought that's the way that you can be white. So yes. And that's it. But since then, I think I discovered that I'm not that white. I'm still walking on my whiteness and drinking pale ale and things like that. But we came from Jerusalem. And I was born in Tira. And Tira is a village, and I write so much about Tira. It's always Jerusalem and Tira. It's the two places that I lived in. I was born in Tira in 1975, and I always refer to that, because the first novel also deals a lot about Tira, and about the stories in my childhood in Tira. And actually also now, the novel that I'm working in for so many years, actually now, hopefully I will finish it by the end of this year, deals about, it's about, again, Tira and Jerusalem. And you know, it's when you ask the Palestinian citizens of Israel, it's this group of Palestinians who remained in their villages after 48 of the establishment of the state of Israel, and they became citizens. It's unlike, there are different groups of Palestinians. Yes, there are the Palestinians who became, most of the Palestinians became refugees during the war in 48, in refugee camps in the West Bank and Gaza and in Lebanon and Egypt and Syria. Huge refugee camps also in Jordan. In Jordan, the situation is different because that was the only, for political reasons, that gave the Palestinian refugees Jordanian citizenship. The rest are not Palestinians around the world. I think around 12 million Palestinians altogether around the world, including Israel and the West Bank. But Jordanians gave the Palestinian citizenship because they wanted to make a favor and to solve the refugee problem for the Israelis back then. But when you talk about these people inside Israel and the Palestinians inside Israel, and we used to be called Israeli Arabs still, actually we can be referred to as Israeli Arabs or the Arabs in Israel, the hometown, Tira, is the place, it will be your Watan or Muledet. Anyone speaks Arabic or Hebrew?
Homeland.
Homeland, yes. It's your homeland, because that's the place usually, and that's the immediate identity. If you ask where are you from, you will say I'm from Nazareth, or I'm from Tira, or from Taibe, or any other Palestinian village. That's the immediate connection. It's the village, and sometimes it's not even the village. It's the neighborhood or the place that you were, the family. If you're lucky that after 48 you received some piece of land. So I was born there, and I always in my first book, and I always referred to my grandmother. I was terrified. As a little boy, I really hated the dark, and I was scared. Not because it's an Arab village, but I was like that. I was scared from the dark, and thieves, and everything. Every little sound under the window would scare me. So I was, and my parents used to work very hard, and they went to bed early. So I would always wait until my parents fall asleep, and then sneak to my grandmother's bedroom. She used actually it was her house before 48, so she used to live with us, but actually was her house, so we used to live with her. And she was a fantastic storyteller. She was a wonderful storyteller, and she knew that every night I would come from my bedroom, sharing with my three brothers. I have three brothers, no sisters, and I come to her room, and she would tell me the stories it's the majority of the stories in my first novel, Dancing Arabs, were about my grandmother, my childhood, and, you know, her stories. And she was a wonderful storyteller, although she was illiterate. And that's the case of most of the Palestinians who remained in Israel after 48 years. We're not talking here about the city or the educated person. If you know a little bit of history, so you know that in 48, most of the coastal villages in Palestine, of course, Jaffa, Haifa, Yafa, were almost completely demolished. And the people who remained in the villages as citizens, usually we are talking about farmers who used to work their lands, not educated. Nationality is a completely new idea for them. So my grandmother doesn't understand. We discussed earlier narratives. She doesn't know what is Zionism and what is narratives, what is the Palestinian narrative, or anything like that. So that was the case. Most of course, when we talk about women, they didn't know to read or write, but still, she was very sharp and very brilliant, and told me so many stories from the Quran about the prophets, and just fairy tales of Shatr Hassan and the magic box. It's that storyteller who used to tour the villages before 48, and about him growing up under the Turkish Empire, and then the Brits, and then Israel. But a major part of her stories were about the war, always the awful war. And my grandmother didn't know to say it's the war in 48, you know. So the Palestinians called that Nakba, the Israelis called that the war for independence. She said she was talking about the war, this awful war that her husband, my grandfather, was killed during the war in 48. And my father was 1 year old back then in 48 when his father was killed. And she was talking about this war and the way she protected her son when the fightings went ugly around the village of Tira, and there were big fights around Tira actually, and how she escaped from Tira to Tulkarim and Kalkilia to the mountains to hide with her son, my father. And yes, Kalkilia and Tulkarim now are part of the West Bank. There's a wall separating Tira and Tulkarim. But back then, those were the Palestinian cities that you would go for school and just walk there, or ride the monkey or the horse to go to Tulkarim and Kalkilia. So it was the awful war, and how she needed to cover sometimes with her body, my father, like in the fields when because of the shootings. And I was raised like that. That the war is the most awful thing that can happen to a person. And they always, but maybe the saddest part in my grandmother's story for me as a child was when the war was over. Actually, my grandmother, she didn't know the Rhodes agreements or the deal with the Arab states, with the Jordanians and the Israelis, and drawing the maps, the green line. That she was told that the war is over, and she was so happy. She said, finally, the awful war is over, and I can go to the fields and bring some food for the orphans, my father and her daughters. And the saddest part of her, the tragic part, that she always cried during that story, that when the war was over, she wanted to go out from the village. From now on, when I talk about Tira as a village, I will talk about the houses and not the lands of Tira. That's the majority of Tira. More than 80% of Tira actually was occupied in 48. And she always tried telling me that there was an Israeli soldier. She said, where are you going? I said, to my fields to bring some food for the kids. I said, you don't have land anymore. And she always cried. And that's for her the whole thing. It's not about the house that she had in Tiro, you know. It's all about the stories and the camels and the cows that used to have. And they spent the whole summer and the season of the spring and then come back only with the first train back to the village, to Tiro, they spent the whole actually season in the fields. They have a different house in the fields called the Hesbe, and they will work in the land. That's the source of life. But she lost all of her land, and that's the Nakba. That's the meaning of the Nakba. When the Palestinians talk about the 48, they will mention the Nakba, meaning the catastrophe. Yes. So what is for the Israelis the Independence Day? It's the Nakba. We talked earlier about the narratives, the Israeli narrative of establishing or building a state, and the Palestinian narrative of the biggest catastrophe that happened to the Palestinians, creating maybe more than anything else the unified Palestinian identity. Yes, the Nakba plays a huge part in establishing this Palestinian identity shared for both refugees, people who stayed in Israel, people in the West Bank, everywhere. So it's about the Nakba. And sometimes, as mentioned earlier, we were sometimes the people who became citizens of Israel. Yes, we were called the Israeli Arabs. We can be blamed and accused by Arabs from the neighboring Arab countries of being, how come you are citizens of Israel, you are traitors, sometimes because they are not aware of the reality of being a Palestinian citizen of Israel. But I remember that we were always told, at least we didn't become refugees. And to be a refugee, to lose your home, according to the Palestinian experience, of course, is the worst thing that can happen to a person, to a human being. Yes, we're talking here about refugees living in tents, losing their homes. So we used to say that at least we didn't become refugees. But I do think that although we remained in our villages, most of us, remained in our villages, we are refugees. We are refugees because suddenly we are citizens of a Jewish state, disconnected completely from the Arab world, from the Arab culture, from the Arab identity, from the nationality of being Arab. And we are talking here about, you know, it's the years that the Arab nationality, of course, we can see that it's failing, but was starting to be established in the Middle East. So disconnected from the language, from the culture, and finding yourself actually a refugee. Although, so we are some kind of a proof that you can become a refugee even if you never leave your village. I think that, of course, there's also a very huge percent of Palestinians who became refugees, but in the state of Israel. For example, both of my wife's parents, they're a little bit older than my parents, they were born in a village called Miski, near Farsaba. And it was completely demolished, yes. They were forced to leave, actually. They were asked to leave within 2 hours, the village. So her parents left the village, and some of them continued to Tulkarim, and after 48 became Jordanians, and some of them stayed in Tira as refugees and became citizens of Israel. So a lot of people who received the Israeli citizenship after 48, they are also refugees because they lost their lands and their villages. Yes, more than 500 villages were destroyed during the war in 48. So those are the stories that I grew up listening to in them, and I didn't know exactly what does that mean. I used to live in Tira. I had no idea that we are poor or that because I didn't need to compare. I knew that there was a war, an awful war, and there are Jews and Arabs, but I just used to live in Tira, and it was for me this protecting environment back then. Nothing from the stories that I was hearing from my grandmother about the war and the Nakba losing the land was mentioned in our books. We belong to the Israeli education system, although in Arabic, but it's the Israeli education system that still, until this very day, you cannot hire a teacher or a principal for the education system for the Arabs inside Israel without the permission of a security, Israeli security intelligence person. So the education, of course, played a huge part in this. So the word Palestine was never mentioned. You cannot find it in our books. There's nothing like Palestine in the history books or in the civic books or anything. we just study, we were forced to study the Zionist Israeli narrative, and we never heard about Palestine or the history of Palestinians. We do study the history of Islam in a very tragic way, but that was not part of the curriculum, and it was not part of the... So it's confusing. You hear the stories at home, but there's nothing like that in the history that we used to study in the school. Actually, my mother maybe was the first female in Tiro to finish her high school and to go to study in the teacher's seminar in Haifa, and she became a teacher, but maybe the first one. Usually, to become a teacher in Tiro, it was enough to finish the 10th grade, and you have the right connections, and you are considered to be a good Arab, you'll be hired. But my mother finished the high school and went to the institution. She studied education and became a teacher. But because of the political involvement of my family, my father was active. Beatles completely, and that was my nickname for Bushiyot, and the dry schnitzel in the dining room, and everything, my accent, and not understanding the language. I knew Hebrew, I studied Hebrew in my school, but it's of course not the Hebrew that I needed in order to follow the teachers. So everything was just I just knew that I don't belong here. Like, it's absolutely a huge mistake, and they have to go away. And one of the best things that happened to me in that school in the very first week is that you realize that Jewish people, as soon as the school year begins, they go back for Rosh Hashanah after 1 week. That was the happiest Rosh Hashanah ever. Like, until this day, I celebrate Rosh Hashanah. I packed my pink bed sheets and everything, took my Hawaiian shirts, and said I go back home and explain to my parents what I'm facing here. There's no way they will send me to this school. So my father took me from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, and that was the first time ever that I needed to take a bus. Now, Tel Aviv, that in 48, yes, we became citizens, was something like 2,000 inhabitants, and now we're talking about 25,000, and still there's no public transportation in Tel Aviv. So for me, it was the first time. And my father used to study in the Hebrew University. My grandmother, actually, this lady that lost, the illiterate woman that lost her land, realized that education is the only ticket out of this situation. So she did her best to send her son, my father, to the Hebrew University. And actually, she worked as a worker in the fields for Israelis, sometimes working in her own private fields. Like, she picked fruit from trees that she planted as a hired worker. But she managed somehow, taking loans and things like that, to send my father back under the military regime, which was rare, to study in the Hebrew University. But he was in his third year in the Hebrew University. My father was arrested because of his political activity, and he spent 2 years and a half in Israeli jails, and it was tough. He didn't talk much about it. Just now I'm doing a research. Someone asked me earlier about the research, so always I do a little research. My father passed away last year. So I'm writing about him. And so he was arrested for the political activities in Jerusalem. And there was a bomb in the cafeteria at the Hebrew University, and people were students, Arab students, were arrested, but also many other activists were arrested under what is called administrative detention. Yes, it's emergency rules. From the British mandate, that still happens until this very day. Meaning that you're not charged of anything. It's just enough to decide that you are a threat, a political threat for the state of Israel, in order to hold you in prison and renew it every 6 months. So he spent 2 years and a half in Israeli jail. Anyway, so he knew Jerusalem. And there was supposedly that Rosh Hashanah to go back home. I packed everything. I'm not going back to Jerusalem. That's it. That's the end of it. I will explain to my parents, and they will understand. So I had to take a bus, and my father just left me a note back then when he drove me. You go to the bus station in Jerusalem, central bus station. You go to platform number 6. You take bus number 947. you drive to Kfar Saba, that's the Israeli town next to us, and they will pick you from there. So I did all of that. I followed my, you know, my father's note, and went to the central bus station, and took the bus. And they had no idea how long it should take. And I remember I sat next to this lady, and after half an hour, 40 minutes, after leaving Jerusalem, the bus stopped. And they asked the lady next to me, is this Kfar Saba? I said, no, this is Ben Gurion Airport. So that was the first stop. And the bus stopped at the entrance of Ben Gurion. I've never been there. And then an Israeli soldier entered the bus. I was less than 15. I didn't carry ID because according to the law, you should be 16. It took the soldier 2 minutes to realize who's the Arab with the Hawaiian clothes. And he approached me, you have an ID? I said, no, I'm 15. And where are you from? I said, from Tira. Do you have bag? Yes, it's in the trunk. And okay, you. So he asked me to get off the bus, and I was terrified. And so I was standing there, and the soldier was checking my bag with, and asking questions. What were you doing in Jerusalem? And who are you? And things like that. And for me, it's. I felt back then I'm a kid, and I'm in front of an Israeli soldier for the first time in my life. I started crying because I was terrified. I know that it was the years of the First Intifada. I saw what Israeli soldiers are doing in the West Bank. I know that they arrested my father, and I know that they killed my grandfather, and I'm here answering questions for an armed soldier. And then at one point, the bus left me with the soldier at the entrance of Ben Gurion, and I was just left there. So I started crying even harder. And the soldier was a little bit panicked. What happened to you? Is it your first time? I said, first time and last time ever. Trust me, you will never see me again in your life. Just please, my father is waiting for me in Kfar Saba. I will never go back to that school. He said, this is Ben Gurion. You are not allowed to enter. The bus driver got to stop there. He will pick you up from, the, he knows, the driver knows. He will stop and will pick you up from that bus stop. So I just took my bag, and I had no idea. And I went to the other bus, and to the other stop, and yes, it took 5 minutes or something, and the bus came back to the same stop, and the door was opened. I entered again the bus, and I think that was when I started to realize about it. It's true that it was difficult to be in school, but then it was, I remember this, you know, the look of the passengers in the bus, and not being able to sit in my seat again because I don't want, you know, this threat to sit next to others. Now with the approval of the soldier, that they know that I'm different and that I'm a threat. I remember I just went to the stairs of the back door of the bus and just like tried to do my best not to cry until we reached Kfar Saba. And I think that was the first time for me to start to realize what does it mean to be Arab, to be Palestinian in Israel, like in a personal way. What does that mean? And it was just horrifying for me. The first bus ever that I took in my life, I was stopped by a soldier. And I remember I went down, in Kfar Saba, and my father was there waiting for me, and I cried in front of the soldier, but when I saw my father, I even cried harder. And my father went, the soldier, Ben Gurion, at the airport, and they arrested me. And my father was like, what happened? And I said, and then it took him a while to realize, like, relax. Are you crying because of the soldier at the entrance of Ben Gurion? So first of all, I was shocked that he didn't think that it's an important matter that he should put in his note, yes? Platform number 6, yes? Being arrested at Ben Gurion, he didn't think that he should mention that. So I was shocked that he knew about the soldier, but he didn't say anything about it. You cried because of the soldier at Ben Gurion? Are you sure you are my son? When the soldier at Ben Gurion confused me with Israeli and didn't take me off the bus, I would stand up with my ID and shout, you motherfucker, I'm Palestinian, take me off the bus. And you crying? Are you kidding me? So I was never a hero like my father. I said, okay, you can do whatever you want. I went back to Tira, to the high school in Tira. I was so happy to be there. Some of the students thought it's a failure, you know, because everyone in Tehran knew that they was accepted to that smart Jewish kids program, and it is the best school. And there was among one of the two Arabs who were accepted that year to that school. And I remember, like I said, my parents, that's it, I cannot do it. I just spent the whole week just trying and focusing on anything. And I remember that it's like I was breaking the heart of my parents. And my father said, "No, like, I need to talk to you. You know, it's your decision. I know, like, just millions of kids want to be instead of you. But I understand you, it's hard for you and it's difficult, but you have to understand that for us it's a disappointment. Because for me it was like, I was so proud to know that my son is good in science and he's going to study physics and math with the Israelis in a very good school, and maybe to be the first Palestinian to build an atomic bomb that we can destroy this shitty state. And if you're gonna miss that, it's your decision." So I thought, okay, yeah, well, it's something that you cannot fight. So basically my father convinced me to go to study with Jewish kids in a Jewish boarding school in order to build an atomic bomb to destroy it. So I went back home, and I remember so bad, I told my father, okay, but there are a few conditions that you have to do with before I go back. I said, whatever you want. I said, you have to go to Kfar Saba and buy me clothes for Jews. Like, make sure it's Jewish factory for clothes. I don't know what that means, but he went there and asked for a Walkman. And because all of the kids in school, they had a Walkman. You know, you know what is Walkman?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah,
okay. Okay, so you know what is a Walkman? It's with a cassette. You know what is a cassette? So my father went and he promised me that I shaved my mustache the first time ever. I went into that and shaved that, and my father came back with, he said, it's Jewish clothes. And I unwrapped the Walkman, and it was and it says Iowa. And I started crying so much because Iowa means yes in Arabic, and I was sure that he bought me an Arab Walkman. Although it was a wonderful Japanese Walkman, but I didn't trust him. Yeah, so it was Iowa. And then I took the same bus again. It's the same bus. There's no other way. If you want to go to Jerusalem from Kfar Saba, you have to take 947 or 945, and you have to go through the Ben Gurion Airport. I was like, my heart was beat. I was with no Beatles, nothing, just the empty Walkman, no cassette, just the headphones, and with the Jewish clothes. I don't know what does that mean. I very much loved my clothes, and they opened. It was before we had a reading in Hebrew. That was the first novel was Emile Ajar, All the Life in Front of Him, by translating from Hebrew. And the second book that I didn't read, that, of course, that's a book in Hebrew, why should I read it? I cannot read it. And the second book that we were asked to read was The Catcher in the Rye. I just opened it, just a fake, I didn't want really to read it. And with the headphones and my heart beating so strong, and the soldier, again, from Ben Gurion, and he came to the bus, and I, until this very day, I don't know if it was like due respect just for the fake. I don't know if I passed as Israeli or just it was like, okay, just for the effort of keeping you on the bus. But I was never asked to get off the bus again in my life. So it was just the first time. Just the first time that I took the bus, I was not arrested, but questioned and humiliated deeply. I was always scared when I took that bus, and I did that hundreds of times, including studying at the Hebrew University, but I was never took off the bus, but just the first time. I always was scared, but and since then, I became a master of faking identity and passing as Israeli. But I started reading The Catcher in the Rye. That was the first novel, maybe, that I read. And I always write about it. I wrote about it so many times, about the influence. Probably I don't remember much about it. Actually now, my daughter needed to write about it and make Pascal, how we say that? Like to choose six songs. Like in a movie, you have the soundtrack of the novel. So I remembered a little bit. But I remember how much it was for many reasons. But first of all, I can't read. Maybe it took me a month to finish that novel. And But I can read Hebrew. I can read Hebrew. I can read a novel in Hebrew. And the second thing was, this is something that I never experienced in my life. I didn't know that you can write that way. I didn't know that you can be mad that way, that you can curse that way, that you can be furious that way. And it was magic for me. I remember when we used to be little, kids, and we used to watch the cartoons in the Jordanian TV. My father would enter the room. I said, are you kidding me? I can't take a cartoon. Just take a book from the library and read it. But we didn't have a library. not at home, not in Tira, not in the school. The first time that I saw a library was when I moved to this boarding school, a real library. Of course, all of the books were Hebrew and a little bit of English. My father thought that he got a library, but basically he got three novelists in the library. It was Marx, Lenin, and Trotsky. And trust me, I was trying to find the romantic and the drama in calculating the value of the war in Russia for many, many years. So for me, that was the future. So it was the library, and it was maybe because of all the kids that taught me that your music, and again, it's not that there were like nasty Jewish kids saying, oh, your language is primitive, and da da da. It's kids can be nasty and they make jokes. And until this very day, my roommates and my friends from the boarding school are my best friends. It's just the way it is. It's not like, oh, you're primitive. It's just you feel it, you get it. It's not because they hated me or something like that. Actually, that the school was some kind of a greenhouse. But it's something that, internalize, that this is your situation, that Om Kulthum is primitive, and that your music and your language and your literature and your less, and if you want to become part of us, and they wanted to become part of them, is you have to culturally go there and understand. So more than physics and math, it was sitting in the library, and it was listening to and taking sometimes teachers. And reading and listening to music and alternative rock. You know, at one point in the second year in high school, people who listened to the Beatles, I didn't talk to them. Like, if it's not alternative rock, if you cannot sing at least two CDs of the Pixies, I'm not going to talk to you. Are you kidding me? So my goal was is to know more literature than them, and more music, and more art than the Israeli kids. That was the goal, and completely neglecting the Arabic language or the Arabic music, and I felt bad. I remember that after that, when my father kept picking me from Kfar Saba and he would play Feroz or something, I would say bad things about it, like, this is primitive, I would say to my father. Queen is good! No, just kidding, it's not, but anyway. No, I stopped also, I didn't like to listen to Queen. And of course then writing. And you know, it took me to go to a Jewish boarding school and to have a wonderful history teacher back then, Dr. Raz Chaim, to start hearing from him even after the class about what the Nakba means. He is part of what it's called the afterwards now. He teaches at the Hebrew University right now. What considered one of the what's called the new historians in Israel. You know, and then only in high school I started to understand what is the ideology, what is Zionism. And what is a national home, and what happened in 48, although still from a very Zionist Jewish perspective, but then I understand why my aunt became a refugee in a refugee camp in Turkana, and what does that mean, and what's the meaning of nationality? Still, I don't know what's the meaning of nationality, but I started to figure out, and actually to realize how the situation is even more difficult and complicated than I ever thought. And I think it was then reading the famous Israelis, besides the translated literature, but reading Amos Oz and Benjamin Tammuz and Aharon Neged and Shai Agnon and many others, and reading about the pioneer, the Israeli pioneer or the Israeli soldier back in 48, then I started to realize, wait a minute, I know a different story. I've been told the story from the other side, from my grandmother, from my father. This is not the story that I've been told, and I have to start writing in Hebrew in order to tell a different story, another story. The truth, according to me, I said, that much in narratives. And even though the after 1982, and actually in literature much more than cinema, the Israelis left wing, yes, and even already in 1967, that there were Israeli writers against the occupation in the West Bank, and so it was more advanced politically, I mean, than cinema or other activities. Literature got its own, it's always in Israel, at least it's ahead, it's or used to be. And even then, when you read the Arab twins in Amos Oz, or if you read the Arab characters with a lot of empathy, of David Grossman, wonderful writers and huge supporters of my work, you know this is not the Arab that you, even if it's like a good Arab that you should sympathize with his misery and being a victim, this is not the Arab that they know, something is wrong here. So I started writing, and Hebrew of course became, back then, I was not fully aware of the meaning of the importance of language in creating nationality and identity, yes? Back then it started with, I want to be part of the strong people, I want to be like them, and I know their language. And it's not only that I know their language, I know what they used to sing to their kids, and I know what stories they used to read when they were little. It's like speaking the Israeli, it's not speaking the Hebrew. I felt like if I want to write in Hebrew, I need to know what my friends in high school read when they were 4 or 5 or whatever, and the music that they used to listen to. And I think that I achieved that, and I started at a very young age to publish short stories. I went immediately after high school to study at the Hebrew University, and then when I was 21, actually, I was already what we can consider a professional writer. I joined Kol Ha'ir. It was a wonderful local newspaper back in Jerusalem. We thought that we were going to change the world. And again, I was the first Arab to be in that newspaper. And so I joined that newspaper in 1996. And since then, I was trying to... And since then, Hebrew is the only language. So it changed. At the beginning, I thought, yes, this is the majority, this is the language. This is the language that I've been reading literature since the age of 15, and I want to be part of the strong people, yes? But meanwhile, Hebrew became the only language that I can use to express myself and write. It's the only language. And when I write, it's much more easy. Like, as a writer, my Hebrew is way better than the way I talk. There are words in Hebrew that I don't know, and I don't dare sometimes to pronounce, you know, but I know how it's written and how it's read in a novel, in a book. And so that's what I've been doing all of my life. And slowly recognizing also how difficult it is, and sometimes how inefficient it is. The use of the language, yes, again, everything is so political, of course, everywhere, but especially there. And so I remember that when the first novel was published, I was just 25 or something like that. I never thought that I'd publish my book. It was published and released wonderful reviews. And at the beginning, I thought no one was going to publish it, but it was on the bestseller book. And I remember the critics that they received in some newspapers in Arabic, and they was completely shocked at the beginning, because they thought that I'm doing I also grew up in a house that, you know, there are the good writers, the good Palestinian writers who are the people who write about the case of Palestine, yes? It's about the cause of Palestinians. It's Hassan Kanfani and Mahmoud Darwish and Samih Al-Qasim and Emil Habibi, very political writers. And I thought that I'm going to be a national Palestinian writer writing in Hebrew and in a very satirical way. I think I was naive enough, so I was criticized just because of the Arabic, yes? And the Arabic for the Palestinians, it who lives in Israel, is more holy sometimes than the Arabic for the Jordanians, because it's part of the national war. It's also, after 48, the Arabic language became maybe one of the only tools that you have in order to protect your identity. You don't have many tools, it's only the Arabic. You're disconnected from the Arab world. And disconnected from your culture, so it's the Arabic, it became so holy. And you're stuck in a stop. You live in a Jewish state, that Hebrew is the language. All of the Arabs in Israel speak Hebrew very fluently. And But when it comes to culture, it's identity, it's culture, it's establishing the identity, the national identity. So you know, it's confusing. You're criticized for that, but it's still the only language that you can write. And it took me a while to realize that it's okay, I can be confused. I think that I earned my confusion in a very decent way. I can be confused for the use of the Hebrew because I was born as a Palestinian Jewish state. And I can be confused when when I'm criticized by the Israelis, oh, he's anti-Zionist and he's just cursing the state of Israel, although he's a huge success here. But I think, yes, I also aimed that, criticizing Zionism and the government and in a very decent way, because I am a Palestinian minority in Israel. And the situation is deeply sad. And Tira that I left, although I don't care about being poor, but Tira that I left in the end of the 90s, nothing to compare of Tira of today. It's I don't care about being poor, but the fact that the violence and you cannot see any hope in Tira, and the protecting place that they thought that they left, it's not worth living anymore. When I see my brothers just most of the day just caring about their own private personal safety, because there's no. Because there's nothing like law enforcement when it comes to the Arab cities, yes? And when I talk again about the village of Tira, it's the case of all the villages inside Israel. And sometimes Israelis want to blame it on your culture and your mentality. No, that's not our culture and that's not our mentality. If you neglect the village for so long, that's gonna be a situation. And most of the Israelis, I don't know how they think, blame it on the culture. When we talk about Tira, the same Tira, almost the same village that was 2,000 people. It's almost the same size of the land that you are allowed to build, 25,000. And all of the people are not allowed to leave their villages, yes? You just live there. So it's a town, it's called a town now, not a village, but still we call it a village, but it's a town, because in Israel if you have more than 20,000 residents, so it immediately becomes a town. But it's a village, the same families, the same eight or nine families that established Tira in the 1948 are the same families here. So yes, you can be educated and you can study at the university, but you are forced to go back and live in the village and to keep the patriarchal family structure. There is no, you cannot talk about democracy really in an Arab village when it's still a family structure. And it's the same villages, not even one Arab village. I'm not a supporter of establishing segregated places for Arabs and Jews, but that's the situation. We are not part of the Israeli society. If Tel Aviv is the biggest city in Israel, town, even Nazareth. Nazareth is just one big village, still based on families. There is no a student here talked to me, asked me about the organization. Much was written about the absence of the Palestinian city, of course, when it comes to 48. There is nothing like that. You are born, you can study, but you will go back to your village. That's the only place. So the Arabs in Israel, the citizens are 20% almost of the population, and they live on 2.5 of the land of Israel. And by law, because the Israeli laws, you know, the Jewish agency, it's just the land is for the Jews. You are not allowed to live in a moshav or a mitzvah illegally. You are not allowed as an Arab. So the segregation is almost full. And even in a city, it is so difficult for an Arab to move to a city. Yes, a few years ago, there was a petition of 50 rabbis of the biggest cities in Israel asking not to rent houses even to Arab students. So the segregation is there, and it's not. Sometimes, of course, also it was. Most of the Arabs would like, I think, to move, but there's no opportunity. So not even one Arab village was established since 48. We're talking inside Israel, I'm not talking about settlements in the West Bank and Gaza. More than 700 villages or settlements for Israelis were established since 1948, and not one Arab village. And that's the situation. You cannot create democracy. You cannot really talk about modernity in this mutation between a village and a big town, between educated people facing, you know, international changes and global changes, but they cannot really practice it, because again, there's the force. Is the structure of the family. And it's not like I'm a huge admirer of a city or organization or modernity. I think that I would live in a village if you have the the way to live in a village, but it's not a village. So that's the situation, and since 48, that was the equation. You go to live in your ghettos, in your you know, as Azmi Bashar wrote, you know, big cheap motels for workers. It was easy because you're never part of the Israeli society. The villages, it's so small, so if you're in Tira, you can work in the streets of Tel Aviv, and in the evening, by the end of the day, you will go to sleep in Tira. And you're never part of the culture or society, or you're not in the scene of the Israeli society. You live in the village. So at the beginning, it was also, you know, for the Arabs, it's the way to protect their identity, you know, to live in the village. But now most of the Arabs would like to go out because it's impossible. It's crowded, it's violent, not because of the mentality, but it's impossible.
I think I talked too much and we should leave some... Yeah?
Okay, any questions? You ready for the exam?
Besides the United States, and why did you choose here?
Yes, I honestly, it was not that. It was not like I decided to leave, and then, you know, I was we planned to leave before, like in advance. I was, the plan was to spend 10 months. I was invited by Grace Center of Artists from the University of Chicago. That was the original idea. But that was for one quarter, and then also, but I knew that it's too short, so I was trying. My agent was trying to find another place, and she contacted the University of Illinois because she got some contact with the Jewish studies there, and they immediately were happy to host me for one semester. So we knew that we were going to the States for 10 months as some kind of vacation. Because I used to work very hard back then in TV and productions. But at one point, we left much earlier than the original plan. I just left in the middle of shooting of a new drama, The Writer, it's called. It was screened last year in Israel. And many other places, actually, in festivals and things like that. So I left in the middle of the shooting. And the shooting, not in Gaza, but the TV show. And then I decided that I'm coming here and try to stay. But before that summer, I never thought that I'm going to stay one day longer than the... Actually, it was more my wife that wanted to take this opportunity. We need to relax a little bit. And being in the States for 1 year is good for the kids, for their English, and we need also some kind of vacation. Both of us worked, I believe, very hard. Last 20 years before we moved. So that was the idea. So the offer was already there. It's not like, okay, where do I go now? Choose something. But I'm not sure that there was another state. And sometimes, you know, when you hear awful things in the news, and so you think about, where should I go? Where is there a safe place for Muslims? Also bad Muslims, but still Muslims. Is there a safe place for refugees or for foreigners? I don't know. Do you have any suggestions? I absolutely don't know. And sometimes I think about, like, I don't think about European something, or usually I think about, I don't know, like maybe Vietnam or something like that. Swear to God, I don't know. Something like that. Because Indonesia, I don't know. Something like that sometimes I think. Because it's not like, in this place they really love Arabs. We go there. And probably, you know, if there's a country that we really love Arabs, like the slogan of this country is we really, I will never go there. I don't want to live there. I want to be, you know, I want people to hate me, but not threaten my safety, you know? I still need to make a living out of racism. It's not the only thing that's the reason that they write. but no, it's not, you know, it's not anything. But it's frustrating, and we left, yes, everything was also the disappointment from what we thought to be the Arab Spring, you know, always, because again, in Israel, the Israelis, when I say the Israelis, it's like, yes, the Israelis are my friends, my partners, my producers, my my neighbors, my kids' friends in school. So for me, the Israelis is the government, it's not the people, yes, just like make that clear. It's the, after all, it's the friends that I miss, and it's the families in the bilingual school and in my daughter's school that I miss so much. And it's my wonderful neighbors and the wonderful teams that we, you know, in the newspaper and the production company, but it's the policy, it's not... I don't think that I ever actually had a personal problem with the Israelis. It's, but you know, it's when you join a fighting team, so that's the... that's the problem. So also, this the frustration was also because of the Arab Spring. And for the Israelis, that it was always, we know that you are discriminated, we know that that you are not equal in Israel, but still, you should be thankful, because you are the only Arabs in the Middle East that got the right to vote, and you are the only Arabs in the Middle East that live in a democracy, although it's not a democracy when it comes to the Arab, yes? Even Israeli scholars will call that ethnocracy, yes, and not a democracy. And yes, you are discriminated, and this state is not for you. I'm talking here only about the citizens. I'm not talking about the situation, the occupation, the direct occupation in the West Bank and Gaza, yes, and the settlements. And that's the thing, you know. And then you should thank God, because we are bringing the light and democracy and modernity to you. And look, would you like to live in poor neighborhoods in Cairo or in Syria or in Iraq or in Yemen? So you should just shut up and be thankful. And that's so frustrating. And again, it's at one point, you internalize that. You look at the Arab world and you have this feeling, maybe they are right. You know, you didn't believe that for many years, and you blame it on the regimes and on the dictators the way it should be. But it became so difficult. And even, you know, it's looking also that the internal problems in the Palestinian society. Yes, I mentioned earlier the Nakba and the threat of Israel that defines more than anything else maybe the meaning of Palestinians. To see the Hamas and the PLO and the Palestinian Authority and the all the powers that fighting each other. And that was not the case. 2 decades ago, and that's frustrating. It's to know that you cannot raise your kids as Arabs. It's not about the language, and it's not about the perfect Hebrew that my kids have, and the language, and being part, after all, of the Hebrew literature, yes, and the Israeli culture. And it's not about the clothes that you wear. It's not about passing as. It's about if you are Jewish or not. If you have a Jewish mother or not, that's the only thing that makes you be equal in the state of Israel. And so that was the case. And then the frustrating thing is that when we left, people were marching the streets of Jerusalem looking for Arabs just to beat them. That was the reality of Jerusalem back then. We decided to move before even the attack on Gaza or the war in Gaza began. It was after kidnapping the 3 teenagers, settlers, and they found the bodies, and in the day that the Palestinian teenager was burned alive, that was when I called my agent and said, I'm leaving now. It took us, of course, a week to find the tickets, and meanwhile the war in Gaza started, and it was even just... But I was completely... As I mentioned earlier, I was just crying for weeks. I couldn't do anything. I felt so stupid. Like everything that I've been told by both sides, from the Israelis when I moved to live in a Jewish neighborhood in Jerusalem, because I don't accept that. I always want, you know, what is Jewish neighborhood? This is a state. I'm a citizen. It's Western Jerusalem, and they deserve to live there. And we were the only Arab family in that neighborhood. That's a good neighborhood. And from the other side, so the Israelis, why do you choose to live here? Why don't you live in the village? Because your mentality, according to the Israelis, is to live in the village. That's your natural culture. Really? Aren't we forced to live in the village? So my answer would be, go ahead yourself and live in an Arab village. And for the Arabs, the same thing. I remember my father, like, okay, you're sending your kids to a bilingual school, the Hebrew is better than their language, and now you're leaving from East Jerusalem to West Jerusalem, and they live in a Jewish neighborhood. What's going to happen with the identity and the roots and the, you know, and culture? What's going to happen to your kids? And I remember, like, when my daughter went to junior high, and it was in Liad, maybe the best school in Jerusalem, junior high, and she was the only Arab kid to be accepted there. And my father was like, what happened to you? Like, if one day you're daughter will come back home and say, Daddy, meet you off, this is my Jewish friend, what's going to happen then? So it took me a while, you know, and then I thought about my father, I think we can count on you off's parents to do the dirty job for us so we can still be liberals, because when it comes to the Israelis are so anti-integration, so they will make that not work. But that was the situation, you know, it's thinking about being in love with Jewish or with Arab, sorry, from the other side, because for me it was not an issue at all. So it's everything, it's where to move. If you move to a city, it's a problem, because there's no education system to support your culture, and the use of the language is a problem. And so what are my alternatives? To go back to Tehran, to this patriarchal family? Again, when I talk about Tehran, I'm talking about 25,000 people. Yes, it is family structure. It is very violent, and killing men, women recently, but also for men, and you know, burning cars and shootings, it's a daily basis. But again, we have to remember that in order to ruin the life of 25,000 people, it only needs 100 people with guns to destroy that life. But there is nothing like law enforcement in the Arab society. And it's their mentality. That's the crazy thing. Is it our mentality? We belong to the state of Israel. The forces, the security, the police, the education system, the health, it's all Israel. But we don't have anything. The Arabs in Israel are not equal in anything. Not even one governmental hospital was built since 1948 in Arab villages. Not even one industrial zone was built in the Arab society. There's like a complete... they shout at you very clearly that this is not your state. This is not where you belong. This is not for you. And the amazing thing that it can be, that's the stage for someone who cannot speak Hebrew and who maybe never visit the state, but it is. If you have a Jewish mother, that's your state more than it's my state and my kid's state. And I believe that all of my life I was acting and fighting through culture as a citizen who's seeking equality. I don't want to destroy the state of Israel. I do care much about my friends, and even though, you know, it was based on colonialism or whatever, yes, but there's a state and people live there, and many, especially Mizrahi Jews who were forced to leave their countries in 48, there's a new reality. And people deserve to live there. No one's talking about destroying. But everything that you write, you know, the comments, oh, you want to destroy the state of Israel. Really? Because I care about the state, because I want it to be a democracy, and because I fight the same way. I just want my kids to have the same future as the kids of my neighbors that used to send their kids to the same school. I want just the same future, the same rights. Is that meaning that they want to destroy the state of Israel? Is fighting... against the Zionist idea of the idea of a Jewish state and only Jewish state is a problem. It's wanting to destroy the state of Israel. It's absolutely not. That's not my thought and my idea. But so there's no alternative. It's either you raise your kids to completely forget their Palestinian nationality, accept Hebrew, and then still you are not going to be accepted as equal. Never. They will always remind you that you are less and that you are primitive and that you are Arab. No matter what you do, there is always this Arab thing inside you, you know? It doesn't, okay, it was this feeling that they were always looking for a mistake, you know, that exposed the Arabness out of him, you know? You know, it's a hidden thing that he cannot control. It's not about money, economical situation, education, it's It's deep in their genes. That's racism. I think that people grow up to hate Israelis, but never as superiors than the Israelis. I don't think that the Palestinians were raised to hate Israelis rather than being the occupiers and the soldiers, and, you know. But in Israel, it's this feeling that you are a better person, no matter what you do. Again, very generally speaking, that's a huge part of the Israeli mentality, the Israeli education system. And the Arabs also, it's not a picnic as well. So it's champagne, I'm white, thanks God, I'm white. And
I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about how history is taught. I mean, it's complicated history. How is it taught in Israel?
In Israel?
Yeah.
Or by in the education system, you mean?
No. Are there any historians who try to capture the complicated nature of this history?
Oh, yes, of course.
At
the beginning, I'm not a historian, so I know a little bit from personal interest and some studies, so that you will study a few things, but not as a historian. So what I know that the history at the beginning, with the establishment of the state of Israel, is to build the history as we have to build the nation. We have to build the nation, and we have to bring stories to connect it from the Bible, and to connect it to the establishment. It's the revival in a very European way. Yes, it's very much like inventing the tradition. Yes, to create that, like in a very, because there is nothing in Israel. So it's parts of history or the culture of Palestine, parts from the Jewish diasporic, a little bit. They usually wanted to erase that diasporic, to create a new, based on history. Yes, just the way that it's a planned, a very strategic plan of building nationality based on the European experience. Yes, the bad experience of the Jewish people in Europe, of course, but how we can take that, create the language, create the history, and make it national history. To connect it to the land, to the Bible, to take the myths of Matsada or different things, and to create to connect the nation to the ancient, and to make a history that is connecting the old people of Israel as it's a nation from 3,000 years ago until this very day, coming back to their homeland. In the history of Israel, all of the Israelis, all of them, are so convinced that they belong to Abraham. It doesn't matter the color or whatever, or of different groups of Israelis. It's like a family. Yes, there is a blood relationship, and that was built by history. And so that's the beginning. And if you mean the history of Israel or the history of how the history was used at the beginning,
yes, well, I mean,
but again, there are historians. So at the beginning, history and historians as serving the nationality, as the literature at the beginning, as the theater at the beginning, as even the art at the beginning. The art a little bit. In 1948 already, this group of Israeli artists said art for the art, not for the national cause, for the cinema. So it was all focused on establishing the history and creating the nation. I think it's only in the late 80s, and especially in the 90s, that there were Israeli historians doubting the hegemonic story or of the establishment of the State of Israel. And it was not based on just last week, it was the debate in Haaretz, yes, between Benny Morris, one of the historians who wrote a lot of the history of the Nakba, and a few other historians, writers, yes. So he did. Benny Morris actually wrote about expelling the Palestinians in 1948, basing that on the British Mandate archives. It was released in the 80s, and then Israeli historians never asking the victims, never. They're there. Go ahead and ask the refugees about their experience. So it always we are looking for the papers. But it's better if it's written by Israelis or someone that we can trust. So there was this movement of the new historians, Ellen Pepe, he left, he just couldn't stay. And there was a discourse in the 90s, after the Oslo Agreement, we talked a little bit earlier about it, of this new historians of the post. So I'm talking about post-Zionism, you know, was not a curse anymore. Yes, people were talking about Zionism as a movement, a national movement, that the goal of Zionism was over with establishment of the state. That's the rule of a national movement, and then we have to focus on the state, creating a democratic, modern, liberal state. But it was that discourse was ended, and most of those historians left. Still, you'll find in the Israeli Academy wonderful people against the occupation, wonderful sociologists and historians and anthropologists against the occupation and teaching that history in the academy. Sometimes, unfortunately, they can feel persecuted. The thing is, it's not difficult only for a Palestinian writer these days to work in Israel. It's also hard for left-wing, what's called radical left-wing Israeli scholars and writers, and they are also accused of being traitors. We have a very right, extreme wing government in Israel, and sometimes wonderful writers like David, Gidon Levy and Amira Etzofaritz can be threatened and can be lynched almost during the Gaza War because of the stories that they are bringing. Yes, we are talking here about the Mankal, the CEO of B'Tselem. B'Tselem is a human rights movement. He gave a speech in the UN just 2 weeks ago about the need of international, he's Israeli, the need of the international involvement in order to end the apartheid in the West Bank and end the occupation. You should see how the Prime Minister is talking about him, to punish him, that he's a traitor. That's the way it works now in Israel. And the problem is, it's not only the right wing, it's not only Benjamin Netanyahu and the Likud talking about this guy. It's also the Labour Party is attacking him, and the Yair Lapid and the mainstream and what's called the center. So probably it's just a small minority in Israeli Jewish people who support such things, you know. You're a traitor if you talk against Israel and different platforms. So it's the hegemonic history that you teach, that's very much controlled, the history in Israel. Like 2 years ago, the one who was responsible for the civic studies in Israel was fired because of his political view. The new civic book written and it was a debate about it, I think 3 or 4 months ago. A new civic, there's no more civic. So, yes, it was there almost no mention for the Palestinians and the Nakba. There was a huge thing about it, like how come? And it's so much control. So I don't know if you talk about the history the way we teach it to the kids or in the army or how you teach it at the university. But I can assure you that some of the scholars are persecuted by the students. I know that from my friends. By the students, right-wing, extreme, powerful movement of students in Israel. Sometimes professors are fired just because inviting one professor to the other. Was fired because he invited Yossi Sarid. Yossi Sarid used to be a minister in Rabin's, but he's considered left-wing. So one professor invited him and he was fired. And it's an amazing thing, but still, it doesn't mean that there are no wonderful historians working there, and they have their, you know, intellectual
debate,
dignity, or whatever. But it's becoming much and much more difficult than in the 90s. The 90s was with the Oslo Agreement, there was a different kind of discourse, yes? Talking about the Nakba now, talking about the two-state solution. In the 90s, they even wanted to include some of the poets of Mahmoud Darwish, the national poet, in the Israeli curriculum, not to talk about the Palestinians for the first time. That never passed, that was denied. But at least they talked about it. And Yossi Sarid was back then the Minister of Education. You know, since then, it's just...
Yes, please. Do you believe that the Palestinian Authority and Hamas have failed the Palestinian people that they represent?
through not by either waging war or not fully.
Well, what? Waging?
By fighting the Israeli state. So do you believe that they have failed by not abiding by many agreements or by breaking from promises?
Well, first of all, the Palestinian Authority has failed the Palestinian people, probably the Palestinian people who live in West Bank and Gaza realized that maybe 1 month after the arrival of the Palestinian Authority. The corruption of the people, they called it it's PLO of the outside. They came from Tunis and you can see their Mercedes and their money and they were the power and you see the locals. Yes, the teacher would earn $200, that was when I was a journalist back then, writing and see that the reality there. It was corrupted since the beginning, and people became millionaires. Usually, again, Palestinians who come from the outside, used to belong to the PLO and the institution of the PLO. And it's true that the Israelis is the major reason for also the breakout of the second intifada, but the corruption and the policy of the Palestinian Authority had also a huge role to play there. I believe very much that Arafat back then he was against the Intifada, but he couldn't stop because he knew that if he used forces against his people, the Intifada is going to be against him as well. So yes, and even if you read Amir Hassan Arach, an Israeli writer, the Palestinian Authority failed very much. And it doesn't, of course it failed. It's still, until this very day, they believe in negotiation while Israel is telling them no. And the problem that Israeli made is making them fail. And they still have the open 20, the security, it's still working between the Palestinian Authority. And that's against the will of the Palestinian people as well, of course. And the Palestinian Authority is now working so hard in order to forbid or to stop the next Intifada. That's for sure. Many Palestinians are calling the Palestinian Authority just to give the keys back to Israel and make it as it is reality. They don't have any power and just make it a direct occupation. So yes, the Palestinian Authority failed, and the Palestinian Authority failed. Abu Mazen, I trust him very well when he says that he doesn't believe in the language of power and violence, and he goes to the UN, but he's getting no achievements whatsoever. Yes, and Israel for them, Abu Mazen is no partner. Yes, and he's the enemy, and he's working in inciting hasata, incitement. Yes. So even Abu Mazen was considered to be the more than any other Palestinian against violence, that he's working with that. In fact, is considered no partner for Israelis. Of course, it's a failure. The Palestinian Authority is they cannot fight settlements, they cannot fight anything, it's just, I think they don't see a good reason. And once in a while, a Muslim would say, that's it, if this next step is not going to happen, there's no reason for the Palestinian Authority, but he's still in power, and still not clear who's going to replace him. They're still fighting, yes. I don't know when they're going to have their elections. And the Hamas, I in no way, like, I have a lot of sympathy and love to the people of Gaza, but I don't have any sympathy to But the Hamas people, they grew up and they are powerful. I believe that if there will be elections now, they will be the only opposition for the Palestinian Authority, and they will win also in the West Bank. That's what I believe. Even as a journalist, back then between 96 and 2000, and being as a journalist, as a reporter, back then in the West Bank and Gaza, to see the behavior of the people of the Palestinian Authority, you knew that Hamas is the only, if you want to resist the corruption, you will vote Hamas. I'm not sure that the people in Gaza now, after experience Hamas, will vote for them again, but that was the reason. If they are failing them, yes, of course. But Hamas is just, you know, that's what happened in Gaza. So Israel, that's the thing, is when you believe that it's only about the violence and power, yes? The Israelis, for them, they say the Palestinians understand only, like in the Arabs, they understand only the language of violence and power. And the same thing the Palestinians. But I think that we were taught by Israel that Israel respects only the the language of violence and power. They're not talking to Abu Mazen, but sometimes they get deals with Hamas. Of course, after killing 2,500 people last summer, but they will reach agreements with Hamas, meaning that they will respect you only if you use power and you use violence. Otherwise, you just shut up, and like don't say anything, don't resist. And any kind of resistance by the Palestinians is not accepted. Going to the UN is they are traitors and they are animals. Demonstration, anything. Like, Israel is not accepting anything from the Palestinians, but shut up, we will tell you what to do, we'll keep taking your land, and you just have to be thankful. And that's the problem. And the problem is, basically, I started this story about the Nakba, but it never ended. Of course, it's not that fast and that powerful, but taking the land and slow ethnic cleansing in the West Bank, still taking the land, even for Palestinians living in Israel, it's in the south. Yes, still, there are villages inside Israel for citizens who are older than the state of Israel, considered unrecognized villages, yes, especially in the south, in the Negev. So the problem is that it's continuing for the Palestinian people. So, of course, the Palestinian authorities are disappointing the Palestinian people. They are involved in disappointing the Palestinian people. The international community is disappointing the Palestinian people. The White House is disappointing the Palestinian people. And even a few things like, okay, don't disturb, just stop the settlements. You know, just follow the international law. It's not even happening. So, yes, a lot of things can disappoint the Palestinians.